Hi there, welcome to this session on services marketing with a practical approach. My name is Dr. Biplab Datta. My contact details are given here, so you can always write to me about any feedback and I will try to answer you as much as possible. So, this is lesson number 12, segmenting the market, targeting and positioning. As I have already discussed, segmentation, targeting and positioning are three arms of marketing strategy. So, here we see the basis for segmentation, the segmentation in practice, targeting a profile segment and positioning our service. Now, basis for segmentation is about what locus you will take for the different ways in which segmentation can be done. So, segmentation is basically some kind of grouping where any group will have similar number of people, similar types of people, and they would be distinct from another group in the market. And so, there is near closeness between people within a group, but there is lot of distance between people of two different groups. So, we go to behavioral basis for segmentation, and the behavioral basis are need, occasions, benefits, user status, usage rate, loyalty status, readiness stage and attitude towards the service. So, under need there are strong needs, moderate needs, light needs or no needs. Then occasions, it could be regular or special occasion. Benefits, it could be a quality, service, economy and speed. These are some of the benefits that people seek from a particular service, and those benefits are given here. Then user status, that means the user is non-user, ex-user, potential user, first time user or regular user of the service. Usage rate, that is light, medium or heavy. Loyalty status, that is the user is a switcher, it shifts loyalty from one brand to another, split between two or three brands, that means keeps on changing between two or three brands. And or hardcore loyal. Hardcore loyal means he is fully loyal to a particular brand and will not change the brand whatever happens. Then comes readiness stage. So, the people might be unaware or aware, informed, interested, desirous or intending to buy, and the attitude toward the service may be enthusiastic, positive, indifferent, negative or hostile. So, these are the behavioral basis for segmentation, because all these are part of the behavior of the customers. Then we come to demographic basis of segmentation. So, demographic basis means with age, family size, income, gender, etcetera. So, age could be under 6 years, 6 to 11 years, 12 to 19 years, etcetera. The family size would be young, single, young married with no children, married with youngest children under 6, young married, youngest child 6 or over, older married with children, older married with no children under 18, older single or other. Then there could be lot of income distribution, like income from 10,000 to 20,000 rupees a month, 20,000 to 50,000 rupees a month, 50,000 to 1 lakh, 1 lakh to 3 lakhs, 3 lakhs to 5 lakhs, like that. There could be income groups based on income. Then there are groups made on based on gender, like male, female and others. So, we come to the new socioeconomic classification system. So, here we see that this system is done in two parts, that is this one, this part and the next part. So, this part has electricity connection, ceiling fan, LPG gas stove, two wheeler, color TV, refrigerator, washing machine, personal computer or laptop, car, jeep or van, air conditioner and agricultural land. So, what we are going to do is we are going to use these items to determine our socioeconomic classification of people. So, what happens is that the surveyors, they would visit a person's home and they would place tick marks based on whatever durables are have been procured by the person, along with whether the person owns any agricultural land or not. So, in this case, the surveyor found out that the person has 8 durables among 11, okay. 8 durables the person possesses. So, the total number of durables are 8. Then we go to the next table. So, here we see that on the x axis are the chief earner education, which is the second question. So, here the chief earner education of the chief earner, he might be literate, but no formal schooling or school up to 4 years, school 5 to 9 years, secondary or higher secondary education, some college including a diploma, but not graduate, graduate, postgraduate or general, and postgraduate, graduate, postgraduate, professional. So, these are the 7 types of people who are literate or illiterate. And then we have the number of durables which we transferred from this table. So, in this table the number of durables is 8. So, we have number of durables from 1 to 9 plus, and we are here 8 according to the person who was interviewed in the in our example case. Now, what happens is that we find out the socioeconomic classification from A1 till E2, from A1 till E2. So, we see that if the number of durables are 9 plus and the person is a graduate, postgraduate, professional, then he is in the A1 SEC segment. So, A1 SEC segment means that he is in the highest position in the society as per his educational qualifications and the durables owned by him. And similarly, there is none, then the person does not have any durable, and say he is illiterate, then he becomes E3. That means, this is the segment to which he belongs, he does not have any durables and he is illiterate. So, from A1 till E3, we have several segments. Now, the first segment, now in our case we have 8 as we saw in the previous slide, and this part is 6, that is he is in the, he is either graduate or general postgraduate. And then we draw the line, so at the intersection cell we have A2, so he belongs to the A2 category. On the other hand, if the person had say 4 durables and he was higher secondary or senior secondary or higher secondary pass, then he would be C1 type of SEC. So, based on these SEC category, we can categorize the villages or different portions of a town or different portions of a city, and accordingly we can understand what he or she does not have and what types of products and brands could be sold to that person or sold to those people. Then we come to the psychographic basis for segmentation. So, here there are 3 types of psychographics: lifestyle, personality and media habits. Now, lifestyle is culture oriented, sports oriented or outdoor oriented. Personality, compulsive, gregarious, authoritarian or ambitious. Media habits, which newspapers, which magazines, which television, which radio, which online, which events and which billboards. So, what does the person actually read, what is the type of personality he has and what is the lifestyle. So, these lifestyle, personality and media habits are again 3 types of psychographic basis which can be used for segmenting the population or segmenting the markets. So, segmentation in practice, how do we do segmentation in practice? So, how does the respondent qualify in each of the behavioral basis of segmentation as given in table 7.1 above? The response would help in establishing why and how people would like to use the service. What kind of price customers would be willing to pay for the service? This information can be used to ascertain the profitability of each segment. What are the demographic bases of the respondents as given in table 7.2, 7.3 and 7.4, depending whether the population belongs to urban or rural region? This would help in identifying the people who had expressed their behavioral intentions regarding the service through the earlier set of questions. What are the psychographic bases of segmentation as given in table 7.5? This would establish the lifestyle and personality of the people who responded to the earlier set of questions. It would also establish the media habits of people. Marketers can communicate, that is advertise, etcetera, with the people with help of their lifestyle and personality associations through their preferred media. The data collected on each of the above question items are then subjected to hierarchical cluster analysis followed by k-means cluster analysis. We can read about this statistical analysis from the books referred below. Then we can interpret the values of the means of each of the cluster items to distribute the cluster, describe the clusters in detail, that is the final cluster centers. We are able to find the clusters that need the service strongly or moderately and the proportion of population that does so. So, we also find the price that this population is willing to pay for the service. We can now identify two specific persons who match each of the cluster descriptions and interview them in detail as to their daily life and how the service can benefit them. The data thus collected can throw additional light into the kind of people who make up each of the clusters and help in designing strategies to reach them for delivering our services. Now, we come to targeting a profitable segment. So, how there, once you have divided the whole market into different segments, then you have to see which segment you should target for selling your products or services. So, it has got five factors. First is measurable, that means the size, purchasing power and other characteristics of segments must be measurable. Substantial, the segment must be large and profitable enough to be served. Accessible, the customers in the segment can be effectively reached for communication and delivery of service. Differentiable, the segments are conceptually distinguishable and respond differently to different marketing mix elements and programs. Actionable, effective programs can be formulated for attracting and serving these segments. So, these five factors like measurable, substantial, accessible, differentiable and actionable, these five factors would be useful in understanding how to target a profitable segment. Then we come to positioning our service. So, our positioning statement would read like the following. For the target segment, our brand is the brand of frame of reference, that is along with the name of the brands which competitors provide, that has a point of difference because it has a reason to believe. So, that brand is different from competitive brands and also it gives a reason to believe in that. So, suppose we are operating an auto rickshaw service. Having prepared the perceptual map, we may like to provide on-demand service as our point of difference that is supported by reliable fleet management infrastructure. Then our positioning statement would read as, for travelers on the move, OnRun is an auto rickshaw service that picks up the traveler wherever and whenever she wants because the service is backed by a reliable fleet management infrastructure. So, this is how we write a positioning statement. The positioning statement is used by every employee of the organization to understand how, what service and how it has to be delivered to people. So, in the next lesson, we will look at services marketing research, the research questions and tools for marketing. Thank you very much for viewing this video. I hope it helps.